Well, happy Monday, everybody, and welcome to Saki Speakeasy Podcast. I'm your host, Saki Speaks. Thanks for giving me a slice of your most precious commodity, your time. I truly, truly appreciate you. Y'all know the routine. Please show my moderator, Love Jones, a little love, please, and thank you, and make sure that you like the video on your way in the door. And if you haven't already, which, of course, I'm always trying to figure out why you haven't already, but if you haven't already, please subscribe to the channel. I promise it's a good time over here, okay? Drama-free, except for what's in these books and whatever these celebrities are getting caught up in. But anyway, after you click subscribe, make sure you click that notification bell and select all so you don't miss out on a chance to chill with us when the speakeasy is open for business. And speakers, I appreciate you guys subscribing, and I hope you find a reason to stick around. And welcome back to my returning sippers and speakers and those of you catching this on the replay. Thanks for coming back one more time to love up on your girl. Because y'all know I love the way that y'all love on me. Now, I heard that I cut out a little bit. I don't even know why that happened, but it's YouTube. What can you do about it? All right, so before we get started, y'all, listen, y'all know how these books give it up. Let me see who's here. But before we do that, y'all, I know it's going to be a minute before we get to Butterfly 5, and here's the reason why. I know that the book supposedly was going to hit Kindle about 18 hours ago. That's not true. About 3 o'clock this morning, my little sister and I were over on Amazon. We were over on Amazon, child, trying to see. It was not there. As of 3 a.m. Central Standard Time, it was not there, okay? So, anyway, moving forward, I don't know if it's being released, you know, by, you know, locale or what the deal is. But at any rate, I'm going to let that lady make her money, okay, before we bust out and, you know, read that over here. I'm not going to do that lady like that, okay? Even though she writes mind-numbingly annoying, deliciously themed books, we are not going to stop her coin, okay? We're going to let her get her coin first. We are going to respect her talent, and, you know, perhaps later on in the year, we'll pick up Butterfly 5, all right? Because that's how we give it up over here. We're going to, you know, let the author, you know, get her coin on, okay? Because she has invested her time, and she deserves to be compensated for that. So, now we can see who's here in the building and we can find out what the fuck Morgan done got herself into today. All right. So, hey, Love Jones, moderator extraordinaire. Happy Monday, darling. Thank you so much for being here. You know, I appreciate you. The first sipper and speaker through the door, honey, was Nordic, who was waiting outside the door, child, trying to get in. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here. I appreciate you. And Marva was right behind her. Welcome, welcome. Thank you so much for being here. Kim Cash is in the building. She was like, bitch, don't start without me because I'm here. Welcome, darling. I appreciate you. Shanae is here. Welcome, welcome, darling. Happy Monday to you. I truly, truly appreciate you. Kay is in the building. Welcome, love. I appreciate you being here. All right, you guys, thank you all so much for being here. Hope y'all like the video on the way in. Let me get my timestamp, honey, so we can knock off a few chapters today. I would like to finish this book today so that we can, you know, tarry on down the road, okay? I would really like to tarry on down the road and get into this next one because I'm sure it's going to be some shit with that one too. That's just the way Ashley Antoinette gives it up. That's the reason why we love her like we do. All right. So chapter 8, Blue sat on her sofa, flipping through case files in front of her. The highlighter in her hand slid over the pages. It was late, too late to be up, but she couldn't sleep. A candle flickered, causing shadows to dance across her ceiling as crickets chirped outside. The breeze that snuck through her window caused goosebumps to form on her arms. She heard the sound of his engine before the headlights that turned into her driveway illuminated her living room. She didn't even rise from her seat. She kept working as the sound of the car door slamming filled the air, then heavy thuds against the wood of her porch as he ascended the steps. "What you doing up?" he asked. "Working," she said, without looking at him. I have to help a lady get her kid back tomorrow. Be a character witness in court on her behalf. I'm just making sure I have everything together. He came into view and Blue rolled tired eyes up to him. He took the papers from her hands. Messiah, I don't feel like hearing anybody's problems but my own right now, she sighed. He sat on the edge of the ottoman directly in front of her and then tossed the papers to the floor. Nigga, this shit ain't no one-sided shit where I just dump my shit on you, but you can't give me some of yours. Start talking, Messiah barked. What problems? Blue sighed and let her head fall back against the couch cushions. Amon wants me and Savior to move to L.A. The room grew so silent you could hear a pin drop. Nah, Messiah answered. Next problem. The laugh that fell from Blue's lips made Messiah smirk as he rose slightly to pull the ottoman closer to the couch. Just like that, huh? She asked. I shouldn't even consider it? You can't consider it. I said no. Now, what else keeping you up? Messiah asked. Blue didn't respond right away. She just looked at Messiah. Never the one to back down, the stare down was returned. Blue looked away first. She wasn't sure if Messiah always won their battles because she led him or because he was simply in charge, but either way, she yielded. This woman who's fighting for her daughter is a recovering addict, Blue said. It just reminds me of myself. This could have easily been me, Messiah. They're trying to take her kid forever, and I'm rooting for her. But what if she gets her baby back and she goes back to getting high? Any little thing can make an addict backslide, Messiah. What happens to her kid if she messes up? What happens to Savior if I mess up? She whispered the last part. This wasn't about the case. It was about her life, about the things that were at stake for her. And that's why you want to move? Messiah asked. Because you want him close to Amon in case you start using again? Blue didn't answer, but she lowered her head as tears filled her eyes. She didn't let one fall. I'm not saying I will. I don't want to. But it's certain shit that terrifies me, Messiah. Like sometimes it's the smallest thing that triggers me. Like when I turn on the stove to cook, there's this sparking sound, this click that reminds me of the sound the lighter would make when Blue's voice disconnected, breaking up as her lip trembled. She looked at him with so much angst. It's just not as easy as it looks, Messiah. Messiah nodded. I believe that, B, he said. That it's hard as fuck. What you need for me to make sure that don't happen? She nodded. Nothing. Nobody can carry this but me, she said. And apparently Amon, Messiah said. He's a good nigga, B, no lie. I fuck with Amon. I know the nigga love you. He's a good father to save you. He do his job, B. But Callie, I ain't with that shit, man. I don't really need permission, Messiah, she answered. The hell you don't, Messiah uttered. He frowned, and he cracked the knuckles on his big hands, then stood. He didn't know what to do with this energy she was giving. You trying to make it work with him, B, or this just about Savior, he asked. I don't know, Messiah. We really aren't the same as we used to be. He couldn't even look at me after I told him I was pregnant by you. He's just now speaking to me again. I don't know what me moving there would mean, but damn, I don't want to be by myself forever. You ain't by yourself, Messiah muttered. Blue half smiled because she knew he believed that to be true. I swear, sometimes it feel like I should just... Messiah stopped speaking and shook his head. You should just what? She asked. You the only one seem to appreciate the fact that a nigga back, Messiah said. Everything around me changed, B, but you're the same. You trying to move all the way to fucking Cali? Can't see that. Can't see me letting that happen at all, B. Why? Blue asked. What am I missing here? You've got your life, Messiah. You have your plans. You know what you came back for. You want Ethic and Mo, and that's an entire family for you. It's just me and Savior over here. What are we around for? There's nothing keeping me here. Messiah stood and hitched up his pants, looking off as he rubbed his fingers in irritation. Thumb to middle finger, they circled. Leave then, B. If that's how you feel, pack your shit and dip, Messiah said. Why are you mad? She asked as she stood too. Everything isn't about what you need. I need things. Savior needs things. Messiah pulled a wad of money from his back pocket and began flicking through the bills. What you need, B, huh? He asked, tossing $100 bills at her. That enough? He kept peeling off money. Blue slapped the entire roll out of his hands. He didn't even bother to pick it up. I will hurt you, Messiah, Blue sneered. Throwing money at me like you're crazy. I am crazy, motherfucker, so stop playing with me. Callie ain't the play. He moved through her home and headed to the kitchen. She followed him and stood in the doorway as he helped himself to the orange juice, tilting the half-gallon carton to his mouth like he had purchased it. Savior needs a father, you asshole, Blue said. You gonna be that? You gonna do that, Messiah? I'll be whatever the fuck he need me to be, Messiah barked. He didn't know shit about fathering a human being, but shit, if that was what her friendship required, he would try. He had tried to be something to her son. He didn't know what, neither did she, but somehow he had become a staple for Savior. And what about me? Blue shouted. She didn't mean to. It just flew out of her mouth, her emotions overriding intellect because Messiah was driving her crazy. Whatever the fuck you need me to be, too. What you want me to be, B? He yelled. Blue's temper had her heaving. Her eyes missed it. This had gone too far. She shook her head. Nah, don't shake your head. Answer the question. Keep it a stack with me. What you want from me? I ain't never not delivered when you ask me for something. What you want me to be to you, B? Blue hesitated. She froze because she didn't know the answer to that question. She just knew she couldn't stay. She couldn't stay in Michigan and keep doing what she had been doing with him for years. The casual nature of friendship, the unspoken bond they shared, the dependency they had created. Nah, she couldn't do that at all. Not anymore. Nobody. I want you to go back to being nobody to me, she said. Lock my door on your way out. She bumped past him, rushing up the stairs and out of sight. That's the end of that chapter. Child, listen. That was the moment for her to tell him, I want you to be my man. Right? Because, like, that would have given him the opportunity to just go the fuck away and stop getting on our nerves. Like, and stop fucking with Miki and Morgan because we want them to be together. Like, this is annoying. Hey, Nikweta. Happy Monday, darling. Thank you for being here. I appreciate you. I don't know. I just wish she would have said, you know, let's take our relationship to the next level. I mean, shit, it had already fucked and had a child. So, like, might as well. I mean, not that that's like, they have the foundation of friendship is what I'm saying. So why not go ahead and just get on down? You know, like, do this. Because clearly Morgan is not feeling you, bruh. Like, so give it up. I'm not understanding what the fuck you holding on for. There's nothing there, sir. There's nothing there. All right. Let me get into this next chapter, child. Clearly. All right. Chapter 9. Morgan sat at the rectangular table, squared shoulders, legs crossed at the ankles, not the knee, in perfect posture. Her hair was swept back in a long French braid, and she wore Yves Saint Laurent. She was perfection. Christiana had laid out her graduation look and had left nothing undone. Morgan Atkins looked like an accomplished woman, a royal woman. She looked like the valedictorian of Michigan State's graduating class of 2020. Thank you for making the trip to see me walk, David, Morgan said, giving kind eyes to Bash's father. Yeah, because we all know he a lame-ass nigga. Anyway, she didn't see him often. He didn't split his time between the States and England the way Christiana did. I wouldn't miss it, Morgan. We all watched you work extremely hard for this over the past 2 years. You earned it, David answered. Morgan smiled graciously. He seemed to be the only Frederick who thought she deserved this degree. Christiana and Bash acted like she hadn't done anything at all. Well, that's a bit generous, but either way, there's cause for celebration today. Matriculation is always a reason to bring out the good china, which I would have done if you had chosen to have your dinner here. We have to drive all the way to Detroit for a decent meal when the staff could have prepared it. But I digress, Christiana said. Lady, fuck you. In the butt. You know, the one that has the stick up it. Morgan opted for silence. She didn't feel like starting her graduation day on a bad note. So instead of arguing, she pushed back from the table. I'm going to head out. I got to be there early and I need to drop the twins off at ethics beforehand, Morgan said. Bash caught her hand before she walked by his chair. I can drive you and the twins can ride to the ceremony with me, Bash insisted. Ethic wants them. Do you want to tell them no? She asked. Bash released her hand. He stood to help her. I've got it. You can finish breakfast with your parents. I'll see you guys later. Morgan walked out of the massive dining room and hurried to grab the twins from the adjoining room. Masari's little slacks, collared shirt, and suspenders warmed her heart. Yara was pretty in pink, but she had already taken off her tights and kicked off her shoes. Morgan shook her head. She grabbed Yara, tossed her shoes and tights inside their bag, then headed for the door. Come on, Mommy, sorry, she sang, knowing he would follow. He came running. Morgan couldn't get away fast enough. Bash had been possessive lately, calling every time she left his parents' estate and picking a fight every time she wanted to go back to her own apartment. Morgan hadn't slept in her own bed in days, and when she left him, she could have sworn he was having her followed. She felt like eyes were on her all the time. She even felt like he was checking her phone at night. Huh, he probably is. She had never been more on edge. She wasn't comfortable anywhere, but she knew she couldn't leave, so she endured. Morgan felt the tension leave her chest when she finally made it to Ethics. Just the sight of the house behind the gate eased her. She typed in the code and eased her car through. After she unloaded the twins, they took off running toward the front door. Morgan used her key and went inside. "I'm home," she shouted. She had been on her way for a few years, but this would always be home. "Mo's here," Easy shouted as he grinned while approaching her with excitement. "Hey, Mo." "Hey, Easy," she replied as she received the quick hug he gave before he bent to pick up Yara. "Come on, man," Easy said to Masari. The three took off up the stairs as Epic came waltzing down. "You look beautiful, baby girl," he greeted. "Fucking college graduate." He said it like he couldn't believe it. He shook his head. "Justine and Benny are smiling today, Mo. Raven, too." "Thanks, Ethic," she said. "I gotta go, but I'll see you guys there." And of course, there's a break in the chapter. Child, listen, why won't she just tell Ethic the truth so he can put a bullet in Bash's head and just call it a day? Like, damn, then she can run off in the sunset with the twins and Miki and leave Messiah with no other option but to be with Blue. All right, the crowd was massive. The stadium was filled to capacity, and Morgan could hear the eager chatter that filled the building from where she stood. She didn't know why she was so nervous. She could hardly stand still as she waited in the reception area where the other graduates congregated. "Can you believe we did it?" Aria asked. "I hate to admit that I'm going to miss this shit." "Yeah, me too," Morgan said, smiling. "Is Issa here?" "I invited my brother. He and Issa can't be in the same place at once. He had a run to make anyway," Aria said. "But my brother didn't even show, so he could have come." "Aria, I'm sorry," Morgan said. "Come celebrate with me afterward. We're going to Ocean Prime for dinner. It's a small thing, but we did this together, so we're going to be acknowledged together." "I might have plans, but I'll try," Aria answered, forcing a smile as she looked around the arena, hopefully. "Is Meek coming?" "We haven't talked," Morgan admitted. Her voice was sad, and Aria reached for her hand. "How about we forget all of them today, Mo? It's not about them, it's about us. We did this. We deserve to go into this day with clear heads and proud hearts. Fuck Messiah, fuck Issa, fuck Meek, and fuck Bash ass too. Fuck everybody except Ethic, because that's Zaddy," Aria teased. Morgan groaned. "It's about us today. It's not about them. It's about us. Black girls sprinkling magic across this stage as we get our degrees. I am sashaying my pretty ass across that damn stage when they call my name," Aria said. "You write your big speech?" "I did," Morgan said. "My stomach is in knots, though. I'll be right back, okay?" Morgan hurried away from the crowd and found solace in the restroom. She was overwhelmed and underwhelmed all at the same time. It was the most accomplished moment of her life, but the fact that she was commemorating it with Bash cheapened it. He wasn't who she wanted to run to when she received her degree. She didn't want to smile for his cameras or hear his voice singing her praises. She had really bound herself to a man she didn't love. She was miserable. She had perfected the art of the fake smile so well that not even Ethic could detect something was wrong. The bathroom door opened and Morgan spun around as his reflection hit the mirror. Shorty doo-wop. In Messiah's hands, he held a turquoise box. He locked the bathroom door. "What are you doing here?" Morgan asked. He walked up behind her and opened the box. He didn't answer her question, and he got so close that Morgan held her breath. Her heart raced as he pressed his body into the back of her. "Messiah, don't," she whispered. "Don't what, Shorty?" he asked. She closed her eyes and gripped the sink, releasing a shaky breath. Something cold hit her collarbone, and she opened her eyes to find Messiah fastening a necklace around her neck. "It's from Tiffany's, your favorite store. I think you said that it was. It's been a while since we had that conversation, but I don't think I forgot," Messiah said. Her fingers went to her neck, touching the gold butterfly charm that hung from the thin necklace. "I don't want it," she whispered, but her heart was fluttering. She swallowed the lump in her throat as she stared at Messiah's reflection. "I don't want anything from you," she said stubbornly. He stared back, moving her braid out of the way as he placed his lips to the nape of her neck. It felt like the kiss of death. She spun on him. "Don't," she warned, pushing him backward. He stepped toward her anyway, and Morgan pushed him again. "I don't want shit from you. Stop coming around like things are good between us, Messiah." "I can't even stand the sight of you," her voice trembled. "I know," he answered as he lifted her onto the sink, opening her legs so he could slide between her thighs. "But you're gonna end up fucking with the kid anyway, so might as well stop playing tough, Shorty." Morgan was livid at his arrogance. Before she could even stop herself, she spit in his face. Ugh, what the fuck? That's disgusting. Messiah pulled back and froze as Morgan stood. She watched him process the disrespect in his mind. She saw the anger flicker in his eyes like a light bulb struggling to illuminate. He used his tongue to lick her spit from around his mouth and then wiped one hand down his face. Anger dissipated and amusement pulled at the corner of his lips. Nothing about Morgan disgusted him. No part of her turned him off. Let me taste something else wet, Shorty, he said. Morgan turned red, inside and out. She hated that he loved every part of her. She bled for this nigga here. Through the good, bad, and ugly, she loved him. Even when she hated him, there was no part of her that disgusted him. Messiah advanced on her, wrapping one hand around her neck and forcing her against the wall as Morgan's eyes lifted to the ceiling. Please, God, she thought. She needed God to shake the table, open the floor, and swallow her whole shit. Something, anything to stop her from wedding for him because her body ignited. There was an exhilaration about the danger of Messiah that pulled her to him like metal to magnet. It didn't matter that she hated him. She resented him with her entire soul, but her panties still soaked. Ah, she moaned against her will. Messiah was a beast, and he was about to capture her. She felt how much he wanted her. God, she felt it. He couldn't do this. Not today. She was supposed to be graduating today. She had her entire family sitting in the front row. Her boyfriend was sitting on the stage. Messiah was turning her into a whole whore, but she couldn't say no. The words evaded her. She couldn't even find her voice to protest. He lifted her onto the bathroom sink and lowered his Nike joggers as he pressed his dark fingers into her light skin. He entered her without thinking twice about hitting her unprotected. Fuck. Messiah groaned. He filled her as his hand tightened around her throat and he pressed the back of her head against the mirror. Morgan was filled with an odd feeling, shame and desire. No way should he be touching her like this, fucking her like this. But her mouth fell open as he provided a high she hadn't experienced in years. His sex was like a free fall, terrifying and exhilarating. It was more than she could handle and made her feel like she were risking it all, but once you jumped out of the plane, you just had to pray the parachute opened. Deprivation made Messiah weak, and he came inside her like no time had passed at all. He pulled back, adjusting his clothes, and she refused to lend him her gaze. When had they become this awkward? When had sex become such a sin between two people who used to partake in it like an addiction? This is a mistake, Morgan whispered, as she placed both hands over her face in disgrace. Messiah fingered the scratches she had put on his neck. They were raw, bleeding, like her heart. He bit his lip and then lifted sad eyes to Morgan. It wrecked him that so much had changed. Years ago, Morgan and Messiah hadn't been able to keep their hands off each other, anytime, any place. They had allowed themselves to indulge in lovemaking. Today, however, things felt so different, it almost felt like he had crossed a line. Well, you did, but oh my God. I cannot stand this dude, yo. Somberness filled him. Morgan was so different now. Real proud of you, Shorty Doo-Wop, he mumbled. She was panting, spent. Her eyes were misted in an emotion she didn't quite know how to identify as she pulled her dress down and turned toward the sink. Everything feels so different, she cried. You waited too long to come back for me, Messiah. You're too late. She gripped the edges of the porcelain as she looked into the black abyss of the drain. Her feelings were so hurt. Messiah made Morgan feel so worthless. Not with bathroom sex, because she had always been down to make love whenever and wherever, but by abandonment. He had discarded her without even thinking twice. She couldn't even look at him in the reflection of the mirror. Then she felt him on his knees between her legs. His tongue parted her sex, cleaning up the mess he'd made of her, sucking her soul out of her body and swallowing it, trapping it. Checkmate, bitch. Soulmates, bitch. An apology for being so cruel. Morgan's eyes snapped closed. Her grip tightened on the sink as Messiah maneuvered underneath her as if he were a plumber coming to tighten her leaky pipes. She bit her lips as he pulled on her pierced clit. He played with the piece of jewelry, the tiny M she kept there, Messiah's pussy. She hadn't forgotten. She'd made sure she'd tagged it so she would never forget. Even in his absence, it had been his for so long. She had waited. And then one day the hood came to London. Ahmeek stepped off a plane, and his reintroduction into her life made Morgan not want to wait anymore. The thought of him caused Morgan's body to tense, and she was grateful for the knock at the door that interrupted them. Morgan, are you in there? The ceremony's about to begin, Arya called out. Mo! Morgan scrambled. Stop, she pleaded weakly, but Messiah kept licking, kept sucking. Messiah, you have to. Morgan's mouth fell open as she came. Just like that, Mo. Some things don't change, Shorty, he moaned. Still eating, still face deep in her. Morgan pushed his head away and Messiah smirked as he stood to his feet, wiping his face with one hand. Headed to class like a motherfucker, he snickered. Enjoy graduation, Shorty. He unlocked the door and walked out, bumping into Arya along the way. Arya stepped inside. Gotta go, Mo, she said, knowing better than to ask questions. Morgan pulled paper towels from the holder and wet them. I'll be right out. Just give me a few minutes, she stammered, flustered. Arya looked at Morgan in concern, but said nothing as she let the door close. What the hell am I doing? She asked herself. Morgan cleaned up as best she could before rushing out. Leave it to Messiah to bombard her greatest achievement with mixed emotions, but she knew she had to tuck them away so that she could make it through the day. That's the end of that chapter. Child, listen, this fucking guy. I cannot, y'all. I'm over this nigga, man. I really, really, really want him to go away, like far away, like really far away. Hey, happy all day. What's your happy all day ass? Welcome, big sis. Thank you so much for being here, and thank you for listening while working. I appreciate you. Wait, what part was gross? Did he put it in there and then sucked it out? Listen, y'all better grow up. Anyway, stay out my business. All right. Hey, Choco Chip, happy Monday. Thank you for sliding into the Speakeasy and bringing a whole truckload of good vibes with you. Child, you know we could use them. I appreciate you. Welcome. Y'all, poor Morgan. She just, like, she is able to tell none of these men no. Everybody except Bash. And child, listen, I'm surprised he ain't kicked her ass and assaulted her. I got a feeling that, listen, Bash, y'all looked at that dude I showed y'all. I showed y'all in that last video how I felt this dude Bash looked. He seemed like the type that just, yeah, he'll do something like get her super drunk or something and try to take advantage of her. I really hope this boy don't end up beating on this girl. For those of y'all that had you've already read it, like, don't tell me, but I got a feeling that he do some fucking bullshit. Oh, you talking about, oh, okay. Well, you know, hey, some people into that shit too. I don't fuck around. You spit on me, we got problems. No, well, I should say you got problems. You'll be sucking soup for a minute. All right, let me, that's if you still breathing, because I don't fuck around. Keep that shit in your mouth, okay? Mm-mm. All right, let's get this this next chapter. I think my thing is messed up. Hold on. Chapter 10. Morgan was so deep in her feelings, she was drowning. The ceremony was torture. She couldn't sit still as she waited for her name to be called. She kept turning to look in the crowd, her eyes scanning hundreds of faces looking for just one. Her heart ached and eyes clouded as she tapped her foot against the concrete floor in angst. Her eyes found Arya, who was seated two rows behind. Her brows knitted in concern as she wiped a tear from her cheek. You okay? Arya mouthed the words as she held up her hands and frowned at Morgan's distressed face. Morgan couldn't breathe. She stood abruptly, interrupting the speaker on stage and bolted for the door. She caused a slight disruption as people whispered as she ran past and she burst out of the auditorium doors and raced for her car. She hopped in and peeled off just as Epic rushed out of the building. Morgan's tears flowed as she pressed her gas pedal to the floor. She reached to the passenger seat, grabbing her phone, her eyes barely on the road as she tried to unlock it. She went to her favorite contacts. He was still the only number on the list. Even after all this time, she had never erased it. She hadn't used it in years. She hoped the number was the same. She touched his name, Sia, and held the phone to her ear, voicemail. Morgan drove faster. When she pulled up to his trap house, she saw him. He stood at the back of an SUV, removing boxes that she knew from experience were filled with a load they had just robbed. Same Messiah, still thugging, still risking it all, risking even more since she was no longer a factor. She pulled up recklessly behind the truck, blocking it in, throwing her car in park. The men standing beside him turned to her in surprise as she hopped out in her cap and gown. Messiah stepped up and Morgan ran to him, practically knocking him over as she threw her arms around his neck. She kissed him so deeply, giving him years worth of passion. He knocked that square hat off her head as he grabbed her braid and returned the kiss. He groaned as she attacked those lips with aggression. Aggression she had hidden, aggression he had taught her, and that she had locked inside for years. She pulled back, placing her hands on his cheeks as he gripped the side of her face desperately. Their foreheads connected as she cried. "What are you doing, Shorty?" he asked in disbelief. "I don't know," she answered, while stroking his face gently. He turned to the man behind him. "Yo, park the truck in the garage and lock shit down. Move her car around the block. I'll meet you back here tonight. I'ma text the details. Be ready," he said in a low tone. "Come on," he said, focusing back on her. He grabbed her hand as they rushed to his bike. He handed her his only helmet. She strapped it on in haste before climbing on the back without hesitation. He kicked off the stand as Morgan wrapped her arms around his body. She leaned into him. He took off. He took her hand and laced his fingers through hers, then balled his fist. Morgan closed her eyes because he took her breath away. She held him tightly as the thrill of the high speeds caused nervous jitters to fill her. An hour outside of the city, they retreated to a hotel and Morgan climbed down, removing the helmet. She sniffed away her emotions, wiping her eyes, and then ran her hands through her hair as Messiah held her under his scrutiny. Morgan looked away, unable to withstand the eye contact. It was like she didn't know him, like she was afraid to be alone with him. He reached for her hand and her feet didn't move. "I need to keep your gun in my bag," she finished. Her words were like a jab to Messiah's chin. He recoiled, stunned. Morgan Atkins, the one person on earth that he would never lay a finger on, feared he would hurt her. She saw the flicker of emotion in his eyes. No one else would have, but she did. "I've been around you since I've been back," he said, looking for an explanation as to why she felt unsafe all of a sudden. "Never alone," she answered. It was a blow to his soul, the fact that she thought he would hurt her, but he reached into his waistline and held it out for her. He wouldn't protest. This was as calm as she had been around him in a long time. This was reminiscent of times past. "It's your world, Shorty. You hold the power," he said. Morgan took it from his hand, clicked the safety on because Messiah never used his safety, and then put it in her purse. The other one, too. It was in order. Her tone let him know it wasn't optional. Messiah's lips lifted on one side, a smirk, a disbelieving smirk. Nobody had ever relieved him of his pistol, not even the police. Morgan fucking Atkins had disarmed him merely with words. He removed it and handed it to her. She removed the clip and checked the chamber, putting the ammunition in her bag, then handed it back to him, empty. He had taught her that. Apparently, he had taught her well. He remembered the day she had been terrified to handle a gun. Messiah scoffed, then led the way into the hotel. They were silent until they entered the room. He went to the bed and sat on it as she stayed near the door. "I ain't gonna bite you, Mo," he said. "Are you sure, Messiah?" she asked. "I barely know you." "Nah, everybody outside these four walls barely knows me." "You know, Mo," he said. "What you doing here? You pulled up on a nigga. What you want, Shorty?" "I don't know," she said, breathless, eyes prickling, as she rustled her hair and turned toward the door. She reached for the handle. "Let go of the door and bring your ass over here," Messiah said. Morgan's hands froze, and she closed her eyes. She turned and leaned her back against the door. "Don't tell me what to do. It's been a long time since you've seen me, so I know you don't know, but nobody tells me what to do." "You let that fucking door go, didn't you?" he baited. "Now bring that shit over here so I can finish eating." Morgan's feet had a mind of their own, and she crossed the room. She stood between his legs, shaking hands, reached for the top of his head as he unzipped the graduation gown. The dress beneath hugged her curves as if it were molded to her frame. She was so damn nervous. Everything was heightened, her senses on alert because this was new for them. Reconnection over anger, over resentment. None of that had existed before between them, but it crowded the space between them now. Still, this moment was inevitable. He had been home too long without this happening. Flashes of what they used to be to each other caused her eyes to prickle. They would spend hours stuck between four walls with each other as the itinerary for entertainment. Trapped in a bubble, their love had grown without sunlight, without water, like the plants that grew between the cracks of urban concrete. They had been resilient until a terrible storm had destroyed them. "Damn, Shorty," he groaned in appreciation. Morgan had filled all the way out. It had been years since he had left her in that hotel room. She had transformed. He hated that somebody else was hitting it. He knew Meek was in it, and it burned him. He suspected Bash may be hitting it, too. Not well. He was almost positive the lame nigga was trying, and the thought set a small fire inside his chest. Little Morgan had some hoe in her with the juggling of two men, and oddly, It turned him on. He lifted the dress above her hips as Morgan stifled her breaths in anticipation. She held his ears, her thumbs caressing the side of his face, a familiar stroke she hadn't done in a long time. His eyes closed. Morgan was such comfort. She knew exactly where to touch, and he felt his nose burn as his emotions tried to push to the surface. He pushed them back down, buried, always unexposed beneath years of bullshit. Morgan knew this was wrong. She was already stretched too thin. Pieces of her were everywhere, stuck to bash like lint to a black shirt, attached to Ahmeek emotionally because even now he was in the back of her mind, but she couldn't stop herself because Messiah owned pieces too. He possessed the most broken parts. At one point, he had held them all because the pieces used to be whole. The pieces used to make up her heart, a heart that beat for him. She straddled him. She pulled back, lifting his face, forcing him to look at her as she sat in his lap while his hands rubbed her behind. She saw a new tattoo on his neck, two M's, one inked on top of the other like a logo, branded on his body like she was the last woman he would ever be accountable to. Like he didn't have the rest of his life to find another one who would dislike the imprint of Morgan on his skin. "Why did you pull up on me, Mo?" "I don't know," she answered again, looking off at the ugly painting on the wall. It was hideous, and Morgan took in every detail of its ugliness to avoid looking at him. She couldn't face him. "You know, Shorty, don't do that. You're supposed to be walking across a stage right now, but you're here." "Why?" he asked. "Because," she started, then stopped. There was a lump in her throat. So much resentment existed between them. "You know how my patience is set up, Mo. Because what?" he pushed. She marked him with angry eyes. "Because, Messiah," she said weakly. Her lip quivered because she couldn't even admit that she needed him. She hated that she loved the feel of his hands on her body. She hated that his eyes on hers felt incredible. Having him back was a miracle. She had never thought she would see him again, feel him again. Her anger had been masking how grateful she was that he was even alive. "You came back," she cried. Her lashes were so heavy from the tears that clung to them. "What took you so long?" Messiah stole her mouth, not giving one fuck about her resistance because he still owned every part of her. He would own her forever. Morgan withered under his touch. She bit him hard. He pulled back and caressed his lip as she pushed him down onto the bed, eyes glossing, angry tears spilling from her, challenging him. He reached up, gripping her neck, and flipped her onto the bed, dominating, hovering over her, one hand squeezing slightly on her throat. Morgan tried to lift, but Messiah grabbed her wrist and pushed her back down against the bed. "It's been 2 years," she said, shaking her head, "and you just show up." Tears rolled from her eyes and pooled in her ears as Messiah hovered over her. Morgan's sobs escaped her, and she turned her head to the side as her chest quaked. "You should have just left me alone." "I can't, Shorty," he groaned as he lowered to her ear. Messiah licked the side of her neck while still holding her wrists hostage. "I'm sorry, I'm a reckless ass nigga, but I'm your reckless ass nigga, and you're a spoiled ass brat, but I'm your spoiled ass brat." She barely managed the words. They were a ghost on her lips. Morgan pinched her eyes closed as he released one of her hands. She used her newfound freedom to grip his head and push him south. Messiah obliged, rolling down her panties and taking her swollen clit between his lips. She was like a pink starburst, the motherfucking best out of the bunch. "I miss this shit, Shorty. Damn," he groaned as he pulled on it with his full lips, hoisting up her hips to press her into him, adding pressure. Morgan's back arched clean off the bed as she grunted. This was wrong. She was in love with someone else, but damn it, how could she deny that behind all that anger for Messiah was indeed the love he had abandoned? She loved his bitch ass, too. She didn't know if she was cheating on her fiancé, cheating on Meek, or cheating on Messiah, but she was definitely cheating. Perhaps herself. She was cheating on her soul, but she couldn't stop. Messiah smeared his face in her wet. Nasty. Nasty as ever for her, especially after all this time. She reached for his shirt, pulling it over his head, and the reflection of his back in the mirror made her eyes mist in disbelief. A mural of her face was staring back at her in the reflection. His body was a canvas dedicated to her. It hadn't been there 2 years ago. That tattoo was proof that he had thought of her while he was away. Her heart ached. It was bawling. She could feel her soul bleeding. How had they lost touch with each other for so long? How had he let it occur? How could he not need her? Not once had he reached out. Morgan had so many questions. "You're back, Messiah," she gasped. He paused and came up for air, his eyes meeting hers. "Every inch of me belongs to you, Mo," he said. A streak of guilt flashed in her eyes because they both knew she had given her body away. So fuck him, he was gone. He got a whole lot of motherfucking nerves. Sorry. He rubbed a gentle finger on the covered up tattoo where his name used to be. She didn't know what to say. "Lay down, shorty," he said as he went back down. Any grudge he held, he took out on her clit. He made light work of her body, sucking that first orgasm out of her so fast Morgan had no time to do anything but bask in it. Colors exploded behind her lids as his soft tongue lapped at the small piece of flesh between her swollen labia. "Ugh," she groaned. "Ah." Messiah came up her body, peeling that dress up along the way. The feeling of his erection dragging against her skin made Morgan weak. Her head spun like an addict's, pining for her first hit. Hoisting her legs over his shoulders, Messiah entered her. "Oh my God," she moaned as her head rolled left, then right. He filled her, every part of her, and Morgan felt him tap on the window to her soul as the familiar aching pleasure made her bite her lip. It was a feeling she hadn't had the privilege of indulging in since him. The pain that came with the pleasure of his lovemaking was uniquely his. Only he could make something this rough feel so good. Ahmeek gave her orgasms back to back, sometimes all night. But Messiah punished her pussy without remorse. He made her take dick even when she couldn't handle it. Even when it was a little past her limit, he made her bite down and endure the ride because, like a roller coaster, once it started, it didn't stop. He kissed the insides of her knees as he dug into her middle, hitting her with deep strokes. He brought her left foot to his mouth, and Morgan wanted to stop him because she knew what he would do next. Her feet had been cramped in heels all day, but when he wrapped his mouth around her big toe, you would have thought she was fresh out of the shower. Her face collapsed in pleasure. Messiah's tongue worked its way between every single one of her pretty phalanges. I'm sorry. Child, I was about to tell y'all something. Get yourself a toe sucker, you heard me? Best feeling in the world, I'm married too. Good googly moogly. Anyway, a word she had learned doing something exactly like this with him during a sex study session. His rhythm never changed, his stroke never altered. He sucked those toes and worked her middle at the same time, and Morgan could feel her temperature rising. She fisted her hair, going crazy from delirium, her head whipping back and forth, her bottom lip lowering slowly as he led her toward a glorious orgasm. Her forehead pinched, and she held her breath as he released her legs and lowered to her ear. "Give me that nut, shorty," his voice demanding, aggressive. Messiah's mean ass held the key to her pleasure. Who was she to defy him? Her body jerked as she rained all over him. "A fucking super soaker, shorty," he groaned as he put one arm beneath her body and hit it deeper, harder. "Oh, fuck," he groaned, deeper. "Messiah, I'm coming." Morgan let the words escape her glossy lips. They were pulled tight in a grimace across her pretty face. Her desperate plea. Was there such a thing as too much pleasure? He was making up for lost time. He owed her a couple, and he planned to deliver. Morgan's nails dug into his back as she shuddered beneath him, his fingers entangled in her hair. The braid was non-existent now from the pulling as he gripped her tightly, burying himself in the pocket of her neck as he came to. Morgan was destroyed as she looked off to the side, tremors never leaving her because now she was crying and crying hard, crying and riding a wave of euphoria at the same damn time, bawling, the one thing he hated to see her do. "Mo," he whispered as he rose slightly, hovering over her. She was trapped in the prison of his biceps as they stretched out on the sides of her head. She noticed another tattoo. The words "doo-wop" on the inside of his arm. She covered her face with both hands, her chest quaking as she cried from her soul, emotion rattling her and hindering him. The sight of her distress was bringing out things in him that he had been able to tamp down in her absence. He had been unfeeling for 2 years because if he allowed himself to feel anything about her, he would murder everyone in his path that kept him from her. "I gotta go. This is fucked up. I gotta get the fuck up and go." She pushed him off of her, scrambled into her clothes. Messiah wasn't quick to go after her. He sat on the edge of the bed, elbows to knees, head lowered. I didn't come back for this, he said. The emotions she brought out in him weakened him. He wasn't comfortable with the control she had over him. This fucking tender spot in the middle of his chest that ached so terribly when she was around, even worse when she wasn't. He couldn't get rid of the shit. It made him feel as if he were having a fucking heart attack. Morgan fumbled with the tight dress, pulling it down and then flipping pillows and covers in frustration. Where the fuck are my panties? Messiah held them up on one finger and she stalked over to him. She reached for them, but he snatched them out of her grasp, bringing them to his nose, then balling them in his fist, trapping them between those chocolate fingers. Ah, shorty, these on me. Morgan shook her head enraged. Nigga, give me my underwear. He stood, dwarfing her with his height, but Morgan didn't back down. He was so close that her breath caught in her throat, her stomach tight and nervous. He made her nervous. You got my mind all messed up, she said, lip quivering. He lifted her chin with one finger and she moved her face. You should have stayed gone, Messiah, she cried. I was moving on. I was putting things back together. I just want to be a part of your important days, shorty, a part of your life, a part of you, like I used to be, he said. Morgan's lashes fluttered as she sucked in air. Today was too much. My bad. I know we ain't there yet, but shorty, it's been 2 years. A nigga dick get hard every time he see you, Mo. That pussy's so sweet, shorty. I just wanted to taste you. Every time I see you, Mo, I want it, he whispered. The angst in his voice told her it was true. He hadn't been able to help himself. He took her hand and placed it on his dick. Morgan gasped. Feel that? He groaned. I don't want to fight with you, Mo. I just want to fuck, shorty. Love you and fuck you. That's it. Morgan's hand massaged him. He was so damn strong. Hard. Big dick ass nigga. Lust made her breaths heavy as she felt her skin flush his mouth. It was disgusting. The things he did with it. Just filthy. She felt her pulse in her clit. Then she felt his coarse hands as they slid up her thigh. Then two fingers, middle and ring, as he wet them inside her. Morgan went up on her tiptoes to run from those two fingers, but he chased her, catching her, her teeth pinched into her bottom lip, and she grimaced from the tune-up he was giving her. His thumb circled her bud. She was goddamn ruined by this man. Even after all this time, the mind control he had over her was uncanny. She guarded the part of her heart that he had touched. No one else could access those depths. She would never allow it, because last time someone had trespassed there, she had been hurt. But he had the key. He could come and go as he pleased. Now, stop talking all that shit nut for me, shorty. Make a mess so I can clean it up, he growled the words to hers. Her legs weakened and he wrapped his other hand around her waist to hold her up. She had always been a good student. A follow every rule, raise your hand to answer every question, obedient type of girl. So she did as he asked. The faces she made as she rained all over his fingers were hideous, but she didn't care. He took those fingers, and just like every other time he had ever touched her there, he put them inside his mouth. You're disgusting. You don't know who you're eating after, she said. She knew what the notion would do to him before the words ever left her tongue. Her eyes blazed with challenge, like a hood nigga who fought pit bulls to make them tough by inciting them, slapping them around a little bit to get them to snap. She was tagging Messiah's ass with those words, yanking his chain, provoking his anger. Her words were like the first strike of a match, the practice strike, the one that made the sound but didn't find its blaze. She was testing him, playing with fire. He could see the challenge in her. She was different, harder, and he smirked. Be careful, shorty, he warned. That's a big trigger you trying to pull. He grabbed her roughly, a thumb caressing her cheek and four fingers around the back of her neck. She pulled away, and he jerked her toward him. I swear you love when I send niggas up out of here over you, he said, as he looked down the bridge of his nose at her through low lids. She pulled away again, and he pulled her right back. Messiah, she gasped. Those S's for Z's. I think she meant the other way around, the Z's for S's. His heart fluttered, and he scooped her, hands under her ass, and pushed her back against the wall. Their lips met, and she was weakened again by his presence, by his kisses. Morgan slapped him. She had a finish. She jumped out of his arms and pushed him, then socked him upside his big ass head as he lifted his hands to block her attack. She was bawling, distraught, as he captured her wrists and pinned them above her head. Stop, he shouted. You left me for 2 years, she cried. Where were you when I needed you? There were so many days that I needed you, and now I don't anymore. You didn't need me, Mo. Look at you. You're a big girl now. You're graduating. You're living. You're getting married, Messiah, and fucking your friend on the side. She finished in a weak admission of guilt. He released her. Words were like a cannonball jolting him back, like a bullet. No, he had been shot before. This was worse than that. The hurt and confusion that took over his face hollowed her stomach. I thought you were dead, and now I'm getting married. She shrugged and held out her arms in defeat. He snickered. Yeah, you want me to kill a motherfucker today, shorty, he said with a nod. Then his eyes went to her ring finger. The brilliance of the diamond sparkled. It was like it had magically appeared there. He hadn't noticed it until now. He had known she was engaged. This wasn't new information, but he never thought she would actually go through with it. He always thought she was playing games, seeking attention because, well, that's what Mo did. But hearing her speak the words so frankly, like it was inevitable for her to be another man's wife, it hit him differently. It hurt with significance. It hurt worse than the molestation he had survived as a young boy. It ached more than the day he'd found his mother murdered. It tortured him more than the look of betrayal he had seen in Ethic's eyes when he had snaked him all those years ago. It affected him more than killing his own sister. Morgan hurt him most with just words. Match to. He felt that fire trying to start, and he smothered it. As the words he was trying to form got stuck in his throat, he gritted his teeth, jaw locked, fists closed unintentionally, as if he were preparing to knock a nigga out. You left me, she said, defeated. I ain't worried. You can't marry a nigga that's no longer breathing, he said. Messiah! His name on her lips, like she were chastising a child she had birthed, but hadn't she? He was a byproduct of her love. That counted. She was his family, his shorty doo-wop, and she was engaged. He thought he had more time. You're gonna murder every man I ever meet? She didn't even know why she was defending Bash. His death would mean her freedom. She wanted to tell Messiah to go ahead, to pull triggers for her because Bash was hurting her, but she knew it would truly mean freedom. It would just be a transfer of power. From Bash to Messiah, she would go. Messiah would kill him for her without a second thought, but then he would expect to take Bash's place, and Morgan wasn't ready for that. Letting Messiah in again, indulging in their obsession for one another, would kill her. She had fought hard to breathe without him, and he would suffocate her all over again. Pretty much, he said. He was so nonchalant that Morgan knew he meant it. Messiah snatched up his jeans and sat on the edge of the bed as he dressed. How long did you expect me to wait? She asked. You never even called. I had shit to get in order, Mo. Shit to handle, he said. Shit that took 2 years, she asked in disbelief as she spun toward the door. She opened it and he came behind her and closed it. Apparently, she wasn't going anywhere. Yeah, Mo, the shit took 2 years. Two long-ass, hard-ass years. I wasn't out fucking with no hoes. I didn't move on. Every day I was on my shit so I could come back for you, so I could get right for you, he shouted. He was frustrated. She could see it rising in him. The guilt she felt eroded her as she stood in front of him. After the woman she had walked in as, you're too late. It's too late, she whispered. How you let this happen, shorty? He asked. Match three, only it was Morgan's fire that came alive. How did I let it happen? No, nigga, how did you let it happen? She shouted as she pushed him. She opened one palm and slapped her other hand inside as she spoke. Bash was there for me, Messiah. He ain't the best man. He has his ways, but he was consistent. Bash, Messiah scoffed and shook his head. Fucking corny ass college boy? Yes, Messiah, the corny college boy. You disappeared and he didn't. He was solid. One days when I felt like taking a razor to my wrist, he would show up out of nowhere. We talked. We went to movies. He cooked for me. We read books together. He was my friend. He saw me through depression. He welcomed me into his family, helped me keep up with homework while raising two babies. He put in the time, Messiah, with the space and opportunity you gave him. She shook her head and stopped speaking as she turned away from him so he wouldn't see her tears. She couldn't believe she was advocating for Bash after what he'd done to her, after the threats and him being physical with her. She was defending him vehemently. It hadn't always been bad between them, and if she was honest, she played a role in the way things had changed for the worst. She was wrecked, decimated by the cloud Messiah had cast over her life. She hadn't been happy without him, but she hadn't been sad either. She had just been coasting on autopilot through each day. His strong hand on the back of her neck, massaging, coercing her to face him, made her feel like she couldn't breathe. She knew he liked to hijack shit, semis her heart, now her air. Damn him for being so good at it. I think about what would have happened if that girl never showed up at your house that day. I think about it every day. When would you have killed Ethic? Would you have killed me, Easy, B? How would it have all gone down? Would I have seen it coming? She closed her eyes as her lip trembled. The thought alone destroyed her. Messiah blew out exasperation and stumbled backward until he felt the bed behind him. He sat and leaned forward, dragging his hands down his face. It was time to address what he had avoided for years. No, you wouldn't have seen it coming, Messiah said, because I'm good at the shit. You wouldn't have known shit until everybody was in the dirt. You only know because I told you to shit, because I loved you too much to keep hiding it, Mo. Hitting you was never an option, Shorty. My issue was with Ethic. Day one I saw you, I wanted you, Shorty. You were young, though, and I knew what I was there for, so it wasn't even an option. But your ass kept chasing it. You kept begging me to pop that. And when I did, it was over. You got in my head that night at the falls, and when I fucked you, and everything changed. I couldn't figure out how to touch Ethic without it tearing you apart. Then I started questioning if it was even worth it in the first place. Ethic was more of a brother than Mizon ever was, but it was pressure on me to make that right. Either I made it right or somebody else was going to come through and make it right. But somebody else might not play fair. Somebody else might touch you or be or easy. I was never touching you, though. Touching you is like touching myself. He sat there so pitiful, so dejected, and Morgan was conflicted. 18-year-old Mo would have wrapped her arms around him. She would have broken every rule to have him a part of her world. But he had proved to be a disappointment. He had burned her, and she hadn't been the same since. At 21, she was a bit older, a bit wiser, a bit tarnished, and she held some resentments. She couldn't deny that she loved him still, even after 912 days. He made her entire body react just by being in her vicinity. He activated her spirit whenever he was around. She didn't know what to say to him. What to do with him? The buzzing of her phone caught her attention, and she picked it up to find she had missed calls. Bash, Ethic, Alani, even Bella had been trying to reach her. I gotta go. Don't marry him, Mo. Messiah's words stopped her feet from working. She was in the threshold of the door. All she had to do was keep walking, but her fucking feet wouldn't move. His hands around her waist, pulling her back into the room. Back into his arms as he kissed the back of her head. He breathed deeply, inhaling her scent because he didn't know if she would ever let him get this close again. She turned around and marked him with sad eyes. She reached into her purse and removed his guns, placing them on the stand by the door. There's a part of me that's gonna always wonder what we could have been, Messiah, but there's also a part of me that will always wonder who I could have been if my son had never come into my sister's life, if my daddy and my mama and Raven were alive. And I had them. When I look at you now, I see him. I don't know how I did see him in you before. The anger issues, the quick temper. I've always been afraid of him, Messiah. I used to be extra good when he was home, try to be extra nice to him so he wouldn't get mad and blow up on my sister. He thought I liked him because I used to pretend to try to keep him in a good mood so he wouldn't hurt her. I was terrified of him, though, and with you being here, it's like I'm a little ass girl again, staring at him, pretending that my heart isn't in my throat. I'm afraid of you now, Messiah. Messiah nodded as his temple throbbed, and he sniffed away his emotion. He was trying his hardest to keep it together. She could see his struggle, but damn if antipathy didn't stop her from soothing him. You know I wouldn't hurt you, Morgan, he said, pained. As he caressed her face, she rested her cheek in the palm of his hand, relishing the moment, holding on to it because it was going to pass soon. He never called her Morgan. He barely called her Mo. It was Shorty Doo-Wop, just Shorty when he was being lazy. He was serious, dead serious, because this was serious. She was giving herself away to another man. That's the problem, Messiah. I don't know that at all, she replied. I'm trying to fix shit, he said, his voice catching. He cleared his throat. I swear to God, Shorty, I'm gonna make it right. I'm gonna make up for all my wrongs. She shook her head. Messiah, she sighed. He kissed her forehead and her eyes lowered until the black behind her lids greeted her. He lived there too. He haunted her. There was nowhere to run because he existed everywhere. He kissed her nose and she gasped. Her stomach lurched as he moved to the valley above her lips. The oddest place, but he deemed it worthy to kiss as well. Her stomach went crazy with anxiety. There was no aggression in his touch. This time, she felt weakness, he took her lips and she let him. It was a soul-stirring kiss, the kind that made electricity shoot through her nerves and made the slightest touch feel erotic. This was the gentlest he had ever been, and it felt so good. It felt earned. Morgan melted. Her head was cloudy, spinning as confusion made a mess of her. She placed both hands on his chest and pushed softly, not really wanting space, but wanting their lips to disconnect so she could breathe, so she could think, so she could find her. No. But as he looked at her, brows dipped low in pain, cheeks heavy in devastation, all Morgan felt was yes. She lunged for him, unleashing the aggression he had taught her, the aggression she had locked away since the last time she had seen him. The buzzing of her cell phone snapped her back into reality. What am I doing? She thought. She pulled away, breaking the trance he had her under. I can't do this, she said. I can't not do this, Shorty, so what we gonna do? Messiah asked. I'm ready, Mo. I'm ready for you. Ready to do whatever I gotta do to make it right, to be your man, Shorty. I have a man, Messiah, she said as she shook her head. He thought she was talking about Bash, but her heart had given the title to Ahmeek. Ahmeek was her man, yes. She was trapped by Bash, but she was trying to figure out how to escape. One day, when she was able to break free, she would be Ahmeek Harris's woman. And I ain't shit because I'm here with you. He doesn't deserve this. I gotta go, she said. Every step she took away from Messiah burned him. He had walked away from her many times before, and if she had felt like this, like she was suffocating, he was sorry as hell because the ache was unbearable. Yo, Shorty, he called out as he stepped into the hall, shirtless, tattoos covering him, marking him up, proving he was a glutton for pain. She pressed the elevator button repeatedly as he strolled up to her. Just let me go, please. I'm gonna let you go. You got a wedding to plan and all, Messiah said with a scoff as he caressed his lips. His lips that still tasted like her. But yo, while you at it, plan a funeral too, Shorty. You gonna need a black dress that day because the day I watch you walk down the aisle to that lame-ass nigga is the day he takes his last breath. Messiah kissed the side of her head and then walked back to his room, leaving her standing in the hallway, heart racing, feeling more alive than she had in 2 years. That's the end of that chapter. Listen. I'm annoyed. Okay? Messiah and his bullshit annoys me. He does. He fucking annoys me. I thought I saw somebody come in. Hey, KTG. Happy Monday. Yeah, you missed a couple chapters. I'm not sure exactly where you came in at, but welcome. Oh, child. No, Messiah does not put it down the best. Ahmeek put it down. He puts it down the best. Messiah just taps into the pained, hurt little girl. Uh-huh. Yep. But Ahmeek puts her back together. That's how I know he puts it down the best. Messiah makes her, he turns her into that unhealed girl that's just down for whatever, that just like she's reaching for something. Fucking Ahmeek. He's a healer. He's got healing hands. But she can help him stroll on over to the dark side. Listen, if I can do it, she can do it. Oh my God. And then that's when the magic happens, you heard me? But stay out of my goddamn business. Y'all always in my fucking business. All right, let me wet my whistle. And listen, y'all got to remember, Ahmeek is, that's a good dude. Ah, child, Messiah was just the first person she loved. That's all that is. He's just the first child. But once she get that shit out of her system, I'm telling you right now, if she didn't have Bash hanging over her head, like she just said, she would be with Ahmeek because that's her man. Mm-hmm. That's Zaddy. Yes, Heaven Meet Meek. I gave him that name. Oh, my God. I should tweet Ashley Antoinette and be like, yes, Heaven Meet Meek. Oh, God. I hope five is the last installment of this shit. I hope Morgan grows the fuck up and gets with Ahmeek and lives happily ever after with the children and is a co-parent with Messiah, or that somebody puts a bullet in Messiah's head, or that he goes on off and, leaves, or lives happily ever after with Blue and, maybe put another baby in her. I don't know. But just get the fuck away from Morgan and they can be, co-parents or whatever. And that way he and Messiah can, keep their brotherhood alive. But I just want him to fuck away from Morgan, though. I want her to be with Meek. I do. I cannot deny that. I do. Yeah. Because I'm serious. I really, I don't want her with him. And I don't know how to make that happen. I really don't. I just feel some type of way. I really do. So, the book's already written. If I would have written it, that she ends up with me. Chapter 11. Morgan glanced down at her phone. She was so late. Taking the Uber to retrieve her car had taken some time. Everyone was waiting for her at the restaurant, and she was over an hour late. Bash had been calling repeatedly. He or she reluctantly answered, "I'm pulling up to the restaurant now." Seconds later, she saw him emerge from the building as she parked. The look on his face told her he was pissed. She couldn't say she blamed him. "Where have you been, Mo?" Bash asked. Or Bash asked. Now, I said Bash asked. Try saying that shit. It's Bash asked. "What the hell was that? You just run out in the middle of your graduation?" "I felt like I would be sick," Morgan said. It was only half a lie. Messiah had thrown her world off kilter. Sorry, I was getting a message and covered up the book and left her stomach in knots. That much was true. "I couldn't breathe up there. I just needed to get out of there. I just needed some time to myself." "Where did you go?" he asked. "To the cemetery," she answered. It was a low thing to use a dead family as a cover, but it was one of the few excuses that people would understand. No one would ask anything further after she said that. She needed Bash to back off. She was drowning in lies. "Get your shit together, Mo. You're embarrassing yourself and my family." "Nigga, fuck your family." Sorry, that's not in the book. Okay. He turned to the restaurant and Morgan trailed him. She felt see-through, like everything she had just done, or rather, that had been done to her, was written all over her body. She still had Messiah's scent all over her, and she was filled with shame as she followed Bash into the restaurant. Alani had reserved the private room in the five-star establishment, and Morgan followed Bash to the section as she pulled on her clothes insecurely. As soon as she walked into the room, everyone in attendance cheered for her. Morgan turned red and she gave up a fake smile. Her eyes immediately found ethics. He sat at the head of the table and the stare he pierced her with made her heart tremble. He spoke without even moving his lips. He nodded. "You good?" Morgan sighed because she realized that with him in the room, she was always safe, always secure. She nodded back and smiled, a real smile. "Congrats, Mo Money," Bella said, standing to hug Morgan. "My sister did it, everybody." The pride in Bella's eyes made Morgan emotional. She hadn't always done the right things. She hadn't always been the girl that Bella could look up to, but this accomplishment was one Bella could aspire to. She moved around the table, speaking to everyone, delivering kisses to cheeks and shaking hands of Christiana's associates. Morgan hugged Easy and Nanny, then moved on to Ethic and Alani. "Thank you so much, Alani, for throwing me this," she said. "You deserve it, Mo," Alani answered. "He almost done cooking in there?" Morgan asked. Alani blew out a sharp breath and placed both hands on her round belly. "Almost. A few more weeks. Thank God, because I'm so ready." Morgan laughed and moved to Ethic, who stood to receive her. "I'm proud of you. You know that?" he asked as he held her close. Morgan nodded and pulled back. "Morgan, we saved you a seat next to Sebastian," David said. "Motherfucker, you and your family, go away! Damn!" "Sorry." Morgan rounded the table and Bash pulled out her chair as she sat down. "So, Morgan, What's next for you? The question came from the white woman sitting at the other end of the table beside Chris, a senator for the state and the keynote speaker at graduation. I honestly have no idea, Morgan said, smiling as she moved the tassel to her graduation cap out of her face. She beamed as servers came around, serving a five-star meal. She didn't even know most of the 30 guests seated at the table, but she was happy to have them there. To her surprise, the vibe was easy. She laughed and conversed with her family, and even Chris seemed to be in good spirits. Morgan tried to imagine her life with Bash, the rest of her days at his side, his baritone in her ear laughing, praising her, her family mixing with his, her twins bouncing around the table, being doted over. This was a legacy at this table. It was royalty. There was power of vast proportions present, and Morgan had a seat among the elite. It was one she didn't even know if she wanted. In fact, she was sure it didn't suit her at all, and somehow here she sat. Aria walked in, still wearing her graduation cap, but the gown was gone. She wore a green pantsuit that complemented her skin so well she radiated. Hey, everybody, she greeted. She instantly gravitated to Morgan's family, hugging Bella and waving to the rest before taking a seat as well. I thought you had plans, Morgan exclaimed. You think I'm missing the opportunity to say your fine ass daddy bought me dinner, she answered. Beaming. She quickly turned to Alani. Sorry, Alani. I love you. I do. But you know your husband is fine, and he's clearly married and got a billion kids, but he's still fine. Speaking of fine, Aria turned to Morgan. Where's your fine ass uncle? Will the good pastor be coming to bless the food? He can bless this plate all day. Aria lifted a hand like she were praising Jesus, and Alani snickered as Chris cleared her throat in discomfort. Aria was always the life of the party, the smallest at the table with the biggest personality she shone in every room. Where is Nye? Morgan asked. Can't show up to Morgan Atkins's graduation dinner empty-handed. Everyone turned their attention to the door and Morgan rose from her seat. Nye stood holding a silver Saks bag. Nye! She ran into his arms. My bad, Mo. I know I'm late. I had to stop off and make sure I came through right for you, he said. He held up an envelope that was so thick it wouldn't close. It was stuffed with $100 bills. A bag to stuff the bag, he said, as he handed over the Saks bag. Morgan beamed as she peeked inside to see a new YSL purse. I miss you, she said. I'm so happy you came. Thank you for the gift, Nye. Wouldn't miss it, Mo. Real proud of you, baby girl, he said. I want to see you more often now that you're home, like we used to. Once a week, Mo. She nodded and he kissed her cheek and then graciously infected the room. The scent of his cologne made the ladies at the table swoon as he shook hands. A kiss to Alani's cheek and a gangster salute to Epic before kissing Bella and Easy. Nair was energy. He always commanded all eyes when he entered a room. Good looks, charm, and regality followed him everywhere he went. Morgan watched him work the room. He was still the same. Gracious and welcoming and comforting. She loved him, and as he took a seat on the other side of her empty chair, her heart swelled. Epic had built a small village for her, for all of them. They had made it to the other side. She remembered her other graduations. At her sixth grade graduation, only Epic had been present. At her high school graduation, it had only been Epic, Bella, and Easy. Today, however, this table was full of support, and even if only half of it was wanted, she had to give them all credit for showing up. There had been so many days when no one had shown up at all, no one but Ethic. Morgan took her seat, but before she could get comfortable, she felt Bash's hand tighten against her thigh. He was squeezing so tightly under the tablecloth that she knew he would leave bruises on her skin. She turned to him frowning, but she got stuck when her eyes landed on the door. Yes! Heaven meet Meek! Ahmeek Harris, black pants, tailored fit, black shirt, no tie, and a leather jacket with leather boots. Morgan knew he'd ridden his bike, and she wanted nothing more than to run out of the restaurant and ride off with him. Morgan's eyes missed it as they met his, but Bash's hand kept her seated. She felt like absolute shit. She had felt nothing when facing Bash after sleeping with Messiah, but looking at Ahmeek, seeing him, hearing him, he brought the aura of love into the room, and it infected her just by looking in his eyes. She had been disloyal to him, letting Messiah touch her the way he had. If Ahmeek knew, he would never forgive her. Morgan loved this man. She loved them both, and it was killing her. She couldn't even breathe as he stood there staring at her. She was transfixed under a spell, Meek shit, as he called it. He was too good for her. He had come to see her despite how angry he was at her, and Morgan had just finished having sex with another man. She felt horrible. She regretted it now in this moment. She wanted to take the past 2 hours of her life back, rewind the clock, and make a different decision. How had she forgotten how much she loved him? How could she do such a terrible thing to him? Even when he wasn't around, even when he was mad at her, he still loved her. She could feel it in the air. It was so potent, it choked her. Everyone at the table felt it too, so they didn't dare disrespect the moment with words. It was silent. Bash's hand was so tight around her thigh, and it hurt so badly that Morgan wanted to scream. I'd have stood up and been like, Miki! Or I'd have fucked with Bash and said, why are you squeezing my thighs so hard under this table? It's just Miki, poo. It's just heavy meat meat. Are you intimidated, B&B, bitch, nigga Bash? I don't mean to interrupt, Ahmeek stated. I'm going to be quick because this ain't really my scene, but I just wanted to say congratulations, Mo. Morgan couldn't look away, and words evaded her. The energy between them was loud, despite the silence that stilled the room. It was like someone had cast a spell over the room because no one spoke. The heartbeat of their connection pulsed through the air. It was felt. Morgan could hear it beating in her ears. I'm fucking up so bad. I'm gonna lose him. She felt so much guilt. She had just given her body to Messiah moments ago, and now Meek stood in front of her, and it felt like he could see her lies. Her eyes glossed as emotion built in her, rising and rising and rising as she bobbed for air in her mind. Meek, why don't you join us, Alani said, filling the awkward silence. Meek ran one hand down his head. Morgan waited. Would he stay? This is a private dinner. I doubt that's appropriate, Christiana added. And since I'm the hostess and you're a guest, I don't really think your approval is required, Alani said. Yes, mama la, to the rescue, bitch. Mind your business, Chris. You ain't pay for none of this, bitch. Zaddy paid for this. And I decide who the fuck gets to stay. Yes. Oh, my God. Morgan couldn't even believe he was there. He had heard her at Aria's. He hadn't forgotten that she was graduating today. Her emotions were already heightened. Messiah had already sent her mind spinning today, but Ahmeek standing in front of her, staring at her like she was the only person in the room, left her breathless. The tension thickened the air as everyone awaited an answer. Thanks, but I'm a breakout, he answered without looking to Alani. No one existed but Morgan. She felt it. The intention he looked at her with. The focus. There was so much she wished she could say. You came all this way. Might as well have a seat, Bash said. You know your neighborhood is nowhere near here. Grab a chair, man. Morgan finally broke eye contact as she looked at Bash in shock. The smug look he wore on his face sent Morgan's temper through the roof. He thought he had the upper hand. He was seated in a 5-star restaurant and his family had a table full of power sitting among them. Morgan could see the contempt burning in Bash as he sat back in his chair and threw an arm around her shoulder. A friend of Mo's is a friend of mine, right, love? Morgan's eyes widened in alarm. He had never called her that before. In fact, he knew that Ahmeek called her that all the time. It was such a passive-aggressive blow that Morgan interrupted him. Bash, please stop, she said in a hushed, pleading tone. Bash stood, grabbing a champagne flute and holding it in the air. I'd like to propose a toast. Mo, you have accomplished something great today, and I'm looking forward to building a beautiful life with you. While we have our friends and family here, we might as well make the announcement. Morgan squinted in confusion. Bash, what are you? Come on, Mo. We might as well share, Bash continued. The reason why Mo won't be entering medical school immediately is because we've decided to expand our family. After the wedding, we're going to try for a baby. Oh, shit, Aria whispered, astonished. Morgan died on the inside. Mixed reactions erupted from the table, but Morgan only cared about one. The revelation landed like a blow to Ahmeek. She saw the fire coming from him. She detected every bit of restraint he used to stop himself from reacting. He hid it well, the devastation. No one else knew. He was too smooth to show his discontent, but Morgan knew she felt it. Bash, stop, she pleaded, whispering as she leaned into his ear. I'm here with you. He gets it. Please, just stop. Stop what, love? Bash asked. Stop while you're ahead, Ethic added, scratching his head and grimacing like the scene in front of him was hard to watch. He stood from his chair and leaned down to Alani. I'm gonna grab a drink at the bar. I'll be right back, baby. a peck to her lips before he walked around the table and put a hand on Meek's shoulder. Not the time nor the place, Ethic said in a low tone that only Ahmeek could hear. Ahmeek walked out and Morgan wanted to go after him, but Bash's hand was like a vice on her thigh. Morgan looked down into her lap, then up at him, her vision blurred as he brought a gentle hand to her cheek, then wrapped four fingers behind her neck, pulling her face to his, a kiss. It felt like the kiss of death. He had just killed everything she and Ahmeek were. Or had she done that? Had she done it when she had turned him away? Morgan struggled to put the fake smile back on her face, but she did it. She sat there at Bash's side, smiling because he wasn't leaving her any choice. She watched Ethic walk Ahmeek to the bar and then darted eyes over to Alani. Alani sat with an elbow to the table. Her chin rested on top of a closed fist. Morgan, Alani called. Morgan's forehead dipped. She was having such a hard time controlling her runaway emotions. She had lost him. She knew it, and it hurt. It hurt more than anything she had ever felt before because it was a hurt she'd chosen. This is pissing me off, like fucking for real, y'all. I just. She looked at Alani again. Alani used her finger to lift her own head, a sign. Morgan nodded and lifted her head, pulling in a deep breath. She had to find her way out of this mess because she couldn't live without Ahmeek. She needed to tell the truth and ask Ethic for help, but fear stopped her. Fear that he would hate her for exposing his secrets in the first place. Fear that he would think she'd done it to be vindictive against his marriage. Fear of being shunned by him altogether. She had pillow talked to Bash in a moment of insecurity, and she was terrified it would be considered a betrayal. She was a dumb bitch. That's my line. Add that to your books if you have a copy. Morgan watched as Ethic spoke to Ahmeek. She had no idea what was said, and the anxiety from that made her chest tight. She hoped Ethic spoke love and not hate. She prayed Ahmeek could feel her heart and see through her actions because everything she did was screaming, fuck him. She watched him walk out and then felt Bash's lips on her cheek. Everyone resumed the dinner. They just went about their meal as if her heart weren't breaking, as if her life weren't ruined. She was in a room full of people and no one heard her screams. It was as if she were deaf all over again. Nobody heard her. She was saying no, but no one understood her language. Child, listen, it's a break in the chapter and I need fucking bacon, like a truckload of bacon. Somebody send me some bacon. This is annoying. I'ma just say I can't stand none of y'all, but especially my little sister. Where's she at? Where's my sister at? There she go. I do this for you, ma'am. I don't give a fuck about Morgan. I like heavy meat. Meek, I do. I love Alani and Ethic. Oh my God. Morgan is fucking annoying because I'd have just been like, Bash is blackmailing me. I'd have fucked up his chances of, I'd have said it right there at the dinner table. I want Meek and his heavy meat. But Bash said he gonna fucking try to hurt Ethic and try to hurt Meek and try to hurt Masai. He gonna try to hurt everybody. Oh, and the kids ain't his. They not his kids. Oh my God. Y'all do not even realize. I'd have just had a whole fucking meltdown right there in front of everybody. You think your bitch ass mama is embarrassed by my behavior? Your mama can see that I love him and that I don't give a fuck about you. Why you can't see it, sir? Why won't you let me go? Why are you trying to hold on to me? You down me, you down my family. Like, why the fuck are you trying to hold on to me? Why do you want me, sir? Trash. Trash, absolute trash. I can't take it. I literally cannot take it. Yes, thank you, Kay, for the bacon. I appreciate you. I do, Kay. Thank you for the bacon, darling. I feel better even with virtual bacon. Morgan was grateful when Ethic switched seats with Nair for the rest of the dinner. Just having him next to her made her feel a little bit better. Ethic made everything better. Yes, Alani can attest to that, which was why she couldn't lose him. He went into his jacket pocket and pulled out a box and set it on the table. For you to open later, he said. She looked at him in surprise. When you're alone, he concluded. She nodded and then placed the small gold box in her handbag. She was able to survive the five courses despite tension coming from Bash. She kept checking her phone to see if Meek would at least text her, but he didn't. She knew he wouldn't. His showing up at all surprised her after what she had done to him. The same way Messiah had sold her a dream only to repossess it, Morgan had done the same to Meek. Messiah's words had shredded her apart, and she had used the same weapon to disconnect from Meek. She had never felt so low. Never had she loved someone so cruelly. He was an unknowing victim. Her hurt had blindsided him, and it was killing her that he thought it was true. The dinner concluded, and Morgan hugged her family goodbye before rising from the table. When she got outside, she stopped walking. Her car was surrounded with floral bouquets. The way Bash's hand tightened around her crushed her fingers. That's some gift. Well played, Sebastian, one of Christiana's friends said. Bash smiled in acknowledgement, but Morgan could feel the anger coming from him. He hadn't sent them. She deserves every petal, he said. Morgan smiled nervously as he pulled her close for a kiss. Morgan turned red as everyone oohed and aahed, but she knew these flowers weren't from him. B, can you help me get them into the car? Morgan asked. Sure, she said. I'm keeping a bouquet for my room, though, she added. Morgan half smiled and stepped to her car. She saw the card under her windshield. Two simple words moved her to tears. Congratulations, Shorty. They packed up the car and Morgan said her goodbyes. My parents will drive your car back. You can ride with me, Bash instructed. I can drive my... Now, Morgan, Bash said. She stilled but didn't budge. It would be a long ride home. Bash and Morgan sat in the parking lot silently as everyone pulled away. The twins had exhausted themselves and both slept uncomfortably in their car seats. The silence and tension that filled the car was maddening. We used to be really good friends, she said sadly. This doesn't feel the same anymore, Bash. Why can't we go back to that? We used to laugh all the time. There were days when I couldn't breathe and you made me laugh. This pressure to be your wife, it's too heavy. I don't want... Bash reached out and gripped her chin roughly like she were a child he had to chastise. Stop talking. I can't believe he showed up here. You're so ungrateful, it's not even funny. He pushed her head away as Morgan's eyes missed it. Did you call him? No, Morgan answered. Did you call him? Bash demanded. No, she shouted again. She didn't know what Bash wanted her to say. She hadn't spoken to Ahmeek, but she wasn't mad that he had shown up. Just seeing him was enough to give her hope that he still cared. Masari stirred and Bash turned rage-filled eyes to the road as he threw the car in drive and pulled off recklessly. I'm beginning to feel like you're not worth the trouble, Mo. Not worth it at all. Well, nigga, let me out. Well, I can go, me and my babies. Man, because they ain't yours. Okay, we can dip, sir. We have a whole fucking gangster zaddy to go home to. And heavy meat meat will be just fine for me, motherfucker. Morgan turned her head out the window so he couldn't see her tears as he drove her back to his family's estate. Bullshit, bitch. Mm-mm. I will leap out this motherfucking car and tell the popo that you're beating me. The fuck? No, you will not keep me caged like a fucking animal. You got me fucked up, but not today. Mm-mm. No, God. Oh, I'm annoyed. I am annoyed. Mm-mm. Right. That's what I'm talking about, Sinead. Child, listen. Nope. I'd have made a whole fucking scene. Hey, Ethic, we going home with y'all. Family night. Yes. I'm not going to the estate with this cocksucker. Mm-mm. No, no, I can't, That's fucked up. I don't even want to read no more. I'm fucking annoyed. Now, you know this child writes excellently when she got me pissed off and ready to put the book down, even though I want to know what happened. I don't really want to read it. I just kind of want somebody to tell me so I can get it over with. Chapter 12. Aria, that dress, Morgan gasped as Aria pulled back the curtain to the dressing room and stepped out into the boutique. Mommy, Auntie Ari is pretty, Yara signed. Yes, she is, Yali, Morgan signed back. TT, you look like a princess, Masari yelled while jumping up and down in front of Aria, arms reaching up high for her to pick him up. She obliged him and gathered him up in her arms. Ooh, boyfriend, nobody wants to look like that, Aria frowned, turning to the mirror in the big Cinderella gown. You don't like it? It's amazing. It's one of the most expensive in the store, the bridal associate added. One of a kind. It's so big, Aria said, fluffing the side of it with one hand. And heavy. I feel like I'm drowning in fabric. I'm not the girl that wants to look like a princess. I want Issa to see me and want to fuck. Aria, Mo shouted as she stood and took Masari from her best friend's arms. My bad, Arya snickered. So sexy. So perhaps maybe mermaid style? The woman asked. I don't know. Not this, Arya said, frowning. I'll pull some options, the woman answered before heading to the front of the store. Arya sat down on the floor, causing the dress to pool around her, and Yara rushed over to play in the folds. Arya laughed as she grabbed Yara's small body, tickling her, and then hugging her tightly. Yara got comfortable in Arya's lap. So he made you bring them so he could make sure you wasn't going to fuck with a nigga, Arya asked. Basically, Morgan answered. He does know that both Messiah and Meek will fuck you with these kids present, don't he? Arya asked. Morgan couldn't help but laugh. Why haven't you told that man yet, Mo? They're his. He deserves to know that, Arya said. It's safe to say he's not going to hurt you or them. So what are you waiting for? I'm just not ready yet, Arya. Sharing them with him is letting him back in. I can't handle him barging into my life. I'm already in over my head with Bash. I don't need more problems right now, Morgan reasoned. You don't get to decide that, Mo. You're being selfish as fuck, Arya said. These are his kids. She lowered her voice on the last part, so sorry wouldn't overhear. He was the king of repeating what he heard, and Arya didn't want to get Morgan caught up. She stood. When Messiah busts your ass, don't cry victim, because he's going to fuck you up when he finds out. Morgan sighed as Arya disappeared behind the curtain to change. We're going to head out. I told Bash I wouldn't be gone long, Morgan called out. Yeah, whatever, girl. You just don't want to hear what I'm saying because you know I'm right, Arya said. She pulled back the curtain, only wearing panties and a bra. She hugged Morgan. I'll call you later. Morgan gathered her twins and headed out into the mall. Mommy, mommy, me want ice cream, Masari squealed from the double stroller he was seated in. Morgan pushed him to the food court and purchased one cone for the three of them to share before finding a quiet spot. She let her twins have free rein as they bounced and played around the table while running up to her for free licks of the chocolate treat. Mommy, more! I want my own, Masari shouted as he pushed Yara out of the way. She fell, hitting the tile floor hard. Masari! Morgan shouted as she bent down to pick Yara up off the floor. Her daughter wasn't as delicate as she seemed. Her pretty face was bunched in a scowl as she reached across Morgan to hit Masari back. Her big baby cried instantly. Masari's little lips trembled as he cocked his head back and cried bloody murder. Mommy, Yali hit me, he screamed as he climbed up her body and rubbed his chocolate-covered face into Morgan's Gucci t-shirt. Yali scrambled up her other leg and tried to reach for Masari, but he was the type to hold grudges, so he turned away from his sister, crying on Morgan's shoulder. Him hit me too, Mommy, Yara signed. Morgan snickered because Masari had indeed passed licks first. I know, Morgan said, winking at Yara before pulling Masari off her shoulder and gripping his chin. She kissed his chubby cheeks. Stop crying, Mommy, sorry. You can't hit people and get mad if they hit you back. But her hits hurt more, Mommy, Masari wailed. It took everything in Morgan not to laugh. Aw, my baby, she cooed as she pulled him close and bounced her leg. She gave Yara a high five behind Masari's back. There was something so special about her baby girl. Yali was gonna give the world hell. Morgan just knew it and she loved it about her. Yara was a fighter. That's right, baby. Beat up the boy, she signed. Yara giggled and then climbed down before getting back in the stroller. You wanna say sorry to your sister, baby boy? Morgan asked. No, Masari said stubbornly. Boys don't hit girls sorry, not ever, even if she hits you first. So go tell her you're sorry, okay? Morgan coached. Masari turned toward Yara. Sorry, he mumbled stubbornly before burying his face back into Morgan's shoulder. Morgan shook her head. He was Messiah's son through and through. Do damage, then label everybody else the bad guy while withholding sympathy. She put Masari down. Climb up next to Yali. It's time to go. Masari did as he was told, and Morgan looked down at her mess of a shirt. Her hair was disheveled, thrown up in a messy bun, and her shirt was now ruined. The boyfriend jeans she had wore had melted stains of ice cream from the twins' messy hands. It was definitely time to head out. She was exhausted, and they hadn't even been out that long. Having two babies was a blessing, but they wore Morgan out on a regular basis. She pushed the stroller through the mall and was halfway to her car when she saw him. In fact, she smelled him first. Ahmeek Harris wore bond number 9. And the way it mixed with the scent of his sweat flashed through Morgan's mind as images of him on top of her body, caused her to stop walking abruptly. Her entire body reacted to him. He was across the corridor, but just his presence made Morgan come alive. An invisible lump in her throat choked her. What's he doing here? With her, Morgan was sick. She stood there frozen in her dirty shirt and raggedy ponytail. She prayed that Meek didn't see her. The universe wouldn't be cruel to her that way, but she knew he would turn her away. She knew the magnetic energy that made it impossible to stop looking at him would guide his eyes her way. He stilled on her for 3 seconds before Morgan turned. She had to get out of there. Away from him, out of this infected place with this tainted air that made it hard to breathe. But before she could, Yara shot across the hallway that separated them. Ahmeek turned away from his date and met Yara halfway, scooping her as she wrapped her arms around his neck. "That's my girl," he said. Morgan almost hated that her daughter loved this man so much. She was jealous. She wanted to be the one with her arms wrapped around his neck. She knew he smelled like bond number 9, and she couldn't wait to snatch her daughter back because she would undoubtedly smell like him, too. "Who do we have here?" Morgan's heart ached when Livy stepped up beside Meek. She was flawless, red bone with a blunt-cut bob that was cut to perfection. Livy switched looks like panties, going from long to short hair by the day because she was pretty enough to pull off any style, a midriff off-white t-shirt and denim lace top. Morgan judged every inch of her perfection from her toes to the top of her head. She rolled her eyes. She didn't remember this girl being this bad. Their only other encounter, Morgan had such the advantage. Oh, how the tables had turned. "This, the queen of the world," Ahmeek said. "You can finish looking for the bag you want. Let me handle this. I'll catch up." "Yes, Meek. Send the trash to the trash heap." Livy looked at Morgan. A smirk played on her lips like she was amused, and Morgan knew why. She had gotten the last laugh. "Bitch," she thought. "You never really cancel a good subscription, like Netflix. You might pause it, but you just keep coming back," Livy said. "Yo, the flex is unbecoming," Ahmeek said. "Go pick out your shit before I change my mind about buying it." Livy's face dropped at the warning as she adjusted her purse strap on her shoulder and turned. "Don't be long, babe," she said. She shot Morgan a look of triumph. "Nice shirt." It was a final jab before walking away. Morgan scoffed and diverted her eyes to Masari, who was sleeping in the double stroller she held onto. Livy turned on her expensive heels and sashayed back into the Louis Vuitton boutique like she had no worries about leaving her man with Morgan. Like Morgan wasn't even a threat at all. Morgan reached for Yara and Ahmeek turned, shrugging her off. "She's where she wanna be." "Why ain't you?" he challenged. "Ooh, girl, tell him, because I can't, because the nigga got me all fucked up." Oh my God. "Why do you care? I see Livy's back, or maybe she never left," Morgan stated. Her eyes betrayed her, filling with emotion as she shook her head. "It ain't even been that long, and you're already..." Morgan stopped talking and pulled in a deep breath. "Just give me my daughter," she said. Morgan reached for Yara, who pulled away and wrapped herself around Ahmeek tighter. Morgan huffed in frustration as she cleared hair from her face. Her eyes were burning so badly, he was already moving on, and it hurt. "Tears and goodbyes don't match, Mo. You stop fucking with me. Not the other way around." "Oh, Lord. Now you're here upset because I'm stepping out with someone else? You out here planning babies with niggas. Ain't that right, Mo? You and your fiance taking it to the next step? You letting that nigga put babies in you? That's what I heard, right?" Ahmeek asked. His temper rose at just the thought. He had denied every single phone call from Morgan since. "No, I wouldn't do that," she said defensively. "I fuck with actions, Mo. Your mouthpiece real good, but you walk different," Meek said. "You know that's not true," Morgan answered. "You know how I feel about you. I know the nigga had you sitting at his side talking about leaving babies in you and calling you love. I know that. Lucky I left air in that nigga's lungs. Lucky I didn't snatch that lace front off that bitch head," Morgan shot back. "Just go back in there with your girlfriend and give me my child," she snapped, a tear slipping down her face. She hated that she was so damn emotional all the time. When she was afraid, she cried. Angry, she cried. Sad, more tears. Even when Mo was happy, she shed emotion. She just wanted to be strong. "What are you doing with her?" She knew she had no right to demand answers. "Whatever I want to do, Mo, I'm single." "You not my girl. You ended the shit," Ahmeek answered as he rubbed the back of his neck. This was too much drama, too much back and forth for Ahmeek. He had never let a woman play with his emotions the way he allowed Morgan to play. She was in one day and out the next. Morgan could see the stress building in him. Stunned, Morgan's eyes widened. Most men would have lied. He served her an unfortunate truth. Right, she whispered, nodding. I forgot. Ahmeek, with all the hoes. Move them in, move them out, right? You're predictable and you're disgusting. Bitch probably been in the picture since I started fucking with you. Ahmeek stepped to Morgan, dwarfing her as he gripped her t-shirt, snatching her close. Her space became his, like he'd paid rent and had a right to occupy it. Yara's head rested peacefully against his shoulder, and he pushed Mo back toward the wall. Jail. She was locked up in Ahmeek, and freedom wasn't an option as he glared at her. You're in your feelings, so I'm gonna let you get that off. Don't feel good, do it. Watching somebody you fuck with heavy give love to somebody that ain't you. It drive you a little crazy, right? Got your blood boiling thinking about me putting my lips on the same place as I put them on you? Got you putting together shit in your head that make your chest ache? It makes me regret ever fucking with you, she said plainly. Every single moment. Yeah, I'm feeling the same lately, Mo. Real shit. None of this should have even happened because you stay on your bullshit, Meek stated. Fucking wasting my energy, yo. Fuck you, Meek, Morgan snapped. Morgan's voice echoed through the three-story building and passers-by slowed their stroll to take in the heated argument. She was making a scene. She was so deep in her feelings that she couldn't help it. He shook his head. This young-ass girl would drive him crazy if he let her. We're done, Ahmeek said. I'm off it, Mo. Coming at me over a bitch when you got niggas in rotation. Your ass and your games. Fuck out of here with that shit, man. Morgan swiped another tear. He was right. She knew it. She didn't care. She was still hurt. You're a hoe. And I knew you were a hoe before I let you in. Ain't nothing special about a whack-ass nigga that's giving out one size fits all dick. His hand pinched the sides of her face before she could utter another insult. A lesser man would have heard her. Meek was well aware of her limits. He issued the warning with no pain, but the look in his eyes told her she was pushing him. Mo was lethal when provoked, and her mouth was her weapon of choice. I don't even see the point in pretending like this shit even matters anymore. None of it matters. Her sister took over her mind. Would Meek slap her? Would he hit her? Would he destroy her? Bash did it. Even Messiah had hurt her. Not physically, but damn if the emotional blows didn't hurt worse than the physical ones. She was so damn tired of building men up in her head for them to not meet her expectations. They always fell short. Defeat was written all over her. Pause. Bitch, you got a whole lot of motherfucking nerves, ma'am. You have been playing reindeer games with this man's heart since day damn one. You have. Yes, the fuck you have, ma'am. You don't get to play little Morgan the victim now. You got a lot of fucking nerves talking about he didn't meet your expectations. Bitch, he gave you the key to his loft, bought you a car, asked you to be his wife. Well, told you that he wanted you to be his wife when you got your shit together. When you're healed, when you're ready. He told you he wasn't trying to trap you in the prison of marriage. Bitch, if that ain't respect from a nigga, I don't know what the fuck is. And you sit here and dare try to play the victim? Girl, fuck you. Oh, my God. This is how you know an author is really like, girl, roll up. She is playing with my emotions, Smokey. This is insane. Ahmeek's eyes changed. Her words altered him. Anger melted into concern because he knew that Morgan could be pushed to the edge. He also knew she wasn't afraid to free fall to the bottom. She had done it before. You have to tell me what we're talking about here, Mo. Keep it a buck with me, because it sounds to me like you're giving niggas too much power. It sounds like you're going to a place that you almost didn't make it back from last time, and that's never going to happen with me around. Good or bad terms, I'm never going to pretend like I don't see the shit and let you fucking drown. So tell me, is this for attention or is this for real? I'm with it either way. You got problems? I got answers, love. Either fucking way. You want attention? I got that for you. I got that all day for you. I'll pay real close attention, Morgan Atkins. Mo tried to roll her eyes and look away, but Ahmeek was in control. He turned her chin back to him. There would be no averting this conversation. If it's something else, if this is serious, if you're in trouble, I need to know. You said you would come to me if you felt like that nigga again. Or if you felt like that again. Niggas don't deserve you. Not even me, love. He brought his face so close to hers that Morgan sobbed. The fuck, Mo? Stop letting niggas ruin you. You're so much better, man. You're so fucking good. Yo, I'd love the shit out of you if you let me. She could see his conflict. Out of everyone, he knew exactly how fragile Moon could be. She bawled right there, hands covering her face, forehead leaned against his chest. The weak spot he had for this girl made no sense. She had him completely caught in her web. Morgan had to be calmer for the many hearts he had broken because she stayed fucking his shit up. Shit's that bad? It can't be that bad, Mo. Talk to me. If you can't talk to me, I can find you someone. But whatever the fuck is going on that got you shutting me out, you gotta settle that. Morgan trembled. This man, holding her daughter in his arms, was offering solutions to problems she hadn't even admitted to herself. It was no hiding place when matters of the heart were concerned. Her eyes told all, and they screamed to Ahmeek for help. Morgan wished she could tell him. The truth she was speaking was a lie, and he knew it. It was like no one else in the entire mall existed, just them in this corner, just him staring in her eyes. Morgan knew she was seeing through, or she was see-through. There's nothing to settle, Miki. It was cool. You were something to do, and now I'm done. I'm bored, so just let it go. I can't fuck with you, Ahmeek. I don't want you. Why the hell couldn't she control her emotions? She wished she could stop crying. Her inner bitch would be so much more believable if she could at least stop her voice from quivering, but damn. Without him, she was mourning. She was grieving a loss of love, a loss of trust. Ahmeek had not only wooed her body, but the finesse of her soul had been extraordinary. He had mind fucked her. Yes, God. Exposing a level of intimacy that felt like a secret only best friends would share. They had spent so much time together that he had unknowingly become the person whose gaze she sought when she found something funny in a room full of people. He was the one who reached for her hand when she felt anxiety creeping up her spine. He was the person who finished her sentences before the words could leave her thoughts. The friendship beneath the sex and passion was so solid that the void he left behind was debilitating. Ahmeek was her inside joke, and now she had to let him go. To keep ethics safe and to stop herself from losing it all, she had to give this up, return it to the forbidden place it had come from. He blew out a sharp breath. The tears gutted him. He wanted to hold her at her word. It was fuck him. So it should be fuck her, but he hated the discomfort that accompanied fighting with Morgan Atkins. Her tears had always done something to him, even before she was his concern. Once I let go, ain't no double back. I ain't with this shit, Mo, the back and forth. I know what I'm about and what I want. That's you, but I don't particularly like the shit you on. I ain't ever let a motherfucker play with me, love. She tried to turn her head and his hand steered her chin right back to him. In my eyes. Morgan melted. Her lip trembled. Even with the mess her feelings had made of her face, she was still the prettiest girl he had ever seen. Ahmeek had been with his fair share of women. He had been with the baddest, but there was something about Morgan Atkins, a daintiness to her that pulled his heart through his chest, that made his dick react when she was around. He lived to hear the melody of her voice. He loved it. It had been far too long since he had indulged in her. Damn, I want you. You acting the fuck up out here. Come home with me, Mo. I can't, Ahmeek. Her voice was so pained that it made his forehead pinch in concern. I want to devour you, love, he admitted. Her pulse raced. Her body hummed. Meeky, no. Why did this man speak to her this way? He was so close. He wanted it. She wanted it more. A life with him seemed impossible, but a day and a long night they could have anytime. Only she couldn't. Too much was at stake. She had to let him go. Her easy love, her steady love. She couldn't fucking have him. She had never wanted to throw a temper tantrum more. Yeah, love, he countered. He was close enough to breathe her air, and Morgan's lashes fluttered. Why are you with her? She cried. Why ain't I with you? Is the better question, he shot back. Because I can't be, Miki. Just leave it alone. Forget we even happened, Morgan sobbed. Morgan felt his lips touch hers and her knees went weak. She reached for his beard and curled her fingers through it, hurting him, gripping tightly for dear life as she indulged in him. I love him so much, she thought. Ahmeek pulled back. Fucking me up, he admitted. Meek! His temple throbbed as he pressed his forehead to hers, as Livy's voice echoed behind him. Tell me what you want me to do, he said. Morgan knew he would end things with Livy if she asked him to. She couldn't ask him to, however, not this time. Bash had set a trap she couldn't escape from. I don't want you to do anything, Mo said. She pulled Yara from his arms and wiped her eyes before squeezing out of his trap. She grabbed the handles of the stroller and walked around it, placing Yara inside. He stood there watching her, frowning, rubbing both hands down his waves and then caressing his lips where the taste of her lingered. Mo, His voice held so much dread that Morgan couldn't stop herself from crying. No, she answered as she rushed away. Yola, he shouted after her. Her feet stopped moving and she looked back. I dig the shirt. You should go back to wherever you got it from and pop another one, he said. It was his shirt, a shirt she'd gotten from his loft because she didn't have clothes there. Or not, Livy said as she looped her arm through Ameek's. Morgan turned and retreated with her feelings as Ahmeek walked the other way. They were putting distance between themselves. With every step, they grew farther apart, but it felt as if she was still trapped against that wall, still staring in his eyes. Her heart beat for him, and she couldn't have him. He was walking away with another girl because Morgan was pushing him out. And that's the end of that chapter. Child, listen, Morgan is a fucking moron. All right, y'all. That's it. I'm going to stop right here because I'm annoyed and I need a break. I cannot. So this was fun. I thank y'all for being here. I truly do. All right. So I know y'all about to head on down the highway of the YouTube verse. Make sure y'all look both ways before crossing the street. There are loose drivers at the wheel and I love y'all. And I want y'all to make it back here in one piece. All right. So listen, thank you, Love Jones, for being such a wonderful moderator, darling. I truly, truly appreciate you. Y'all be good. Look out for the next thumbnail. I'll put it out there right after this one. But y'all need a break. Like Morgan has, I don't even know what the fuck I feel right now. Just fucking mad, yo. I'm just fucking mad. Oh my God. I'm annoyed. All right. So listen, y'all look out for the thumbnail. I don't even know if I'm coming back later on today. I need a motherfucker. This girl has, I don't know. Just be looking out for it. Y'all, this is a lot. And I really want to finish up this book so we can get on to the next one. I don't know. We might take a break between this one and the next one. Like for real, y'all, because like Ahmeek does something to me. He reminds me. And fucking Morgan, she upsets me. Ethic does something to me. He reminds me. Like, this is just like, it's just, I don't know. Anyway, I don't even know what to say. And I think Morgan annoys me most because Aria and Issa Aria and Issa, like if I really had to pick a favorite couple, it's those two because because it be like that sometimes. Stay out my fucking business, Marva. Damn. All right. So yeah. Aria is me. I take it for you. Oh my God, yes, punishment, hurt me, hurt me. Listen, anyway, let me get the fuck out of here. Y'all don't even understand. You hear me? All right, so listen, yeah, I just need a break. I may do something else in between the end of this book and the next one simply because, I need something else to focus on. These motherfuckers got me out here fiending and shit. Like, and then I'd be pissed off and mad and like, I don't even know who the fuck I'm mad at. Like, these are not real people. So yeah, that part. All right. So listen, y'all go forth and be great. Just enjoy what remains of the day. Oh, and I want to say this to y'all. It was put on my heart to say this. It costs you nothing to be kind to people. Because everybody out here is going through something, okay? And people are really, really just doing the best they can with the hand that they were dealt, all right? So just show a little grace to people, right? I know we're all going through our own shit, yo, and it's real easy to pop off. It's real easy to think bad thoughts. But think about you. and everything that you're going through, and how you would want somebody to just show you a little bit of grace, because they have no idea the shit you battle just to be upright and alive and out in the world. Everybody that you see in front of you, everybody that you encounter, is going through the same thing. They're struggling, y'all. They're just trying to be upright and out in the world, right? And not be out here wilding the fuck out. Because it's real easy to get murderous, right? To turn into Meek and Messiah and Issa and turn the town red, like for real, okay? It's very easy to do that, both verbally and energetically. Listen, sometimes actually, you heard me? But show people some grace. I ain't saying you gotta fuck with the people just because you show them grace. But if somebody is popping off in front of you, look at them the same way you would look at a toddler throwing a tantrum. They literally are full up. They can't help it. They don't know any other way to express themselves in that moment. So they're opting to just rage. Let them be. Let them be. Because your day might come and you would want somebody to just let you be, for them to just understand that, listen, home, work, school, relationship, neighbors, life, everybody is on me today. And you, I don't really mean to lash out at you, but you the motherfucking straw that broke the camel's back, and I can't, so I'm giving it all to you. You don't even deserve it. But just like, right? So you would want them to show you that grace, because your day will come. Trust and believe. And you don't want nobody to just knock your fronts the fuck down your throat like you want to do somebody else. You don't want them to just verbally assault you, right? You know how you prevent that? By showing a motherfucker some grace. That's called lessening your karmic retribution, right? You're making the retribution that you're going to get later on down the road a little bit lighter. That's it. It don't cost you shit to show a motherfucker grace. I promise you, it don't cost you nothing. You know, is we are, as human beings, we always want to show, yeah, I don't let a motherfucker just walk on me. You walk on me, I'm going to give you the business. You say some shit to me, I'm going to give you the business. Oh, let me tell you something. To react without thinking is nothing. It takes nothing. Anybody can do that. A kid does that. Grown motherfuckers do that. But grown motherfuckers, people that are all the way adult, they think about, how are the words that I'm about to say to this motherfucker, how would they impact them? How would it impact me if somebody said it to me? Am I trying to save face? Or am I trying to salute my spirit and protect my peace? Because when that karma train, when that karmic retribution train pulls in front of your door and goes, choo-choo, baby, all them cars attached to it, it's all the times you popped off. All the times you took the fucked up route instead of the route that you knew to take. All the times that you did some shit that you knew you ain't have no goddamn business doing, but you did it any motherfucking way because you thought, well, fuck it. Who am I hurting? Nobody. Right. No, you're hurting yourself. So when that fucking train pulls up and goes choo-choo, you're going to have to deal with that. You're going to have to deal with that. So why not lighten the load a little bit by showing somebody else some grace? Because trust me, the universe is paying attention. Source is paying attention. And it says, oh, so-and-so showed other so-and-so a little bit of grace. All right, I'm going to take one car up off their karmic retribution train. And every single time that you put yourself in the position of the other person, your train gets a little bit shorter. And eventually, ain't going shit pull, nothing pull up but an engine and a caboose. That's the way my shit looks. Now, it might be a whole lot of coal in that fucking engine, awesome thing, but my shit looks like an engine and a caboose right now. I might be getting ready to do some shit that fuck that all up. But listen, as of right now, it's a goddamn engine and it might be one car. Because I did have some. Listen, stay out of my goddamn business. My point is, you do not want your train to be a mile long. And right now, some of y'all got a train that's a mile long. And it costs you nothing to show another motherfucker some grace, y'all. You ain't got to show your ass and show out in front of the people and show how bad you are. Being Billy Badass is for kids, teenagers, people in their early 20s. Some of y'all old enough to know better. Some of y'all old enough to have been known better. Y'all have no idea how much grace I done shown motherfuckers. A lot. And when I say show grace, I don't mean you gotta fuck with the person, because that's not what showing grace means. It don't mean you fuck with them. It means you don't fuck them up because you can. You make the choice not to. That's what showing grace is. They wilding out in front of you, calling you out your name, lying on you. You could stand there in front of them or virtually and do the very same shit back. But showing them grace is not doing it. And then watch how the universe bless you. I ain't telling you what the fuck I heard. I'm telling you what the fuck I know. So yeah, it don't cost you shit to be kind to people. You don't know what people's struggles are. Yeah. People out here struggling to keep their shit bound together and appear whole out here. But some of them are hanging by a fucking thread. So walk light with people like a woodpecker with a motherfucking headache. The life you save just might be your own. Y'all be easy. I love y'all. And until next time, please salute your spirit and protect your peace. Bye, y'all. Let me be clear about something. I'm not telling you guys to be anybody's doormat. That's not what I'm saying. I thought about that once the music started. I'm not telling you to just let people mistreat you. But I'm saying, given the choice between responding from a place of anger, on impulse, to not look weak or look like a punk or look like you're scared, given the choice between doing that and saying, I don't know what this person's struggle is. I don't have to break them just because I can. That's what I'm talking about. You could just bow out. Because the beneficiary of the blessing is you. Sure, you didn't punch them in the fucking face, but you also didn't add another car to your karmic train. That's what I'm saying. All right? I hope y'all understand what I'm saying. I probably need to do a video about this, but ain't nobody got time for that. All right, bye, y'all.